Hi, I'm Dr. Mark Salzburg, and tonight we'll be talking about ferrets, so stay tuned to Pet Owners Hotline. Welcome to Pet Owners Hotline. I'm Dr. Mark Salzburg. Tonight on Pet Owners Hotline, we are looking at ferrets as pets. People have shared their lives with pet ferrets for thousands of years. This small member of the weasel family endears itself to owners with its fun-loving personality and silly antics. They provide companionship and often a bit of mischief for their owners. Ferrets are known for getting into places they shouldn't, probably because of their intelligence and amazingly limber ferret anatomy. They are also known to be thieves that enjoy nothing more than stealing an insole, hiding a pen, or running off with keys. Tonight we have Terri Lewis, a ferret expert. She has a wealth of ferret experience. Welcome to the show, Terri. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
And first of all, tell me who you brought so we can, we're going to bring them all out, or all, but bring both of them out later. But we have two ferrets tonight.
We do. This is Una, and Annabelle is sleeping, but
Annabelle
we'll get
is
her
sleeping?
Out. Yeah.
Okay, we can bring her out.
It's been a long day.
So tell me a little bit about ferrets. So let's start from the beginning to, you know, to kind of all the way through.
Most people, when they get ferrets, they get them when they're maybe 8 to 12 or so weeks old. From pet stores, typically carry them. When you buy them, they've already had one round of shots, although you do need to take them to the veterinarian to get the rest of their boosters, and then also yearly for vaccines. They've been altered, meaning they've been spayed or neutered. And descented, although they are still a musky-smelling animal, and that's something you have to be aware of if you're going to get one. That's typically where most people get them, although they do have them at humane societies and they have them at shelters. There are rescue organizations that house strictly ferrets, but that's typically where you would find them.
So they get them about 8 to 12 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
There are a few, I know of a few producers of ferrets in the country.
Mm-hmm.
Like you said, they've already been surgically altered. They've been neutered, either spayed or neutered for the males.
Mm-hmm.
And they've had their primary scent glands taken out.
Mm-hmm.
They all have accessory scent glands. So again, that is a warning for people that make sure you get in there. If you really think about a ferret, because they are pretty neat, you really, really want to go spend some time holding them and smelling them.
Right.
And you can bathe them, right?
Oh, yeah. Just like any animal, you don't want to overbathe. And a lot of people do want to do that because they're kind of a musky odor. So that's not something you can handle. You probably don't want to get a ferret. But it's not something that's going to, you know, smell up your whole house or anything. But you can definitely, they have a different smell to them.
Yeah, they're a little stinky. but most people are willing to put up with it. And after a while, you kind of get used to it, too.
Yeah. And as long as the main thing you have to remember when you're trying to control that is that if you keep the bedding clean and their litter box scooped every day, then that's going to cut down that smell significantly.
Right. Okay. So tell me about housing. What kind of housing do they require?
I prefer, rather than a wide cage that's long on the floor, I prefer when it's stacked. The more levels, the merrier. 4 levels, 4 feet or 6 feet is a good ferret cage. You can have hammocks. They're a big believer and lover of hammocks. And they also like to have a lot of space, a lot of different areas to sleep. They just eat ferret food. You can get any pet store. Carries several different varieties of ferret food. You don't want to do cat food or dog food. Stick with the ferret food. Fresh water, obviously. They can drink out of a water bottle. Or they can drink out of a bowl. Doesn't matter. The thing to remember, too, is while they do need a cage, especially when you're not home, they really need a lot of time out of the cage when you are home, safe time, in a ferret-safe zone, because they do need to have interaction.
Do you think that having one ferret's okay, or do you think ferrets do better if they're a couple of them?
It's certainly okay, but a lot of the things that I've read suggest threes, because they do a lot better with another ferret. And if you're going to be having ferrets, and eventually when you lose one, then at least you still have a friend for the other one. It's not just one left by itself. But I've had just a single ferret and really haven't had no problems with it.
And because they come already, the vast majority of these ferrets come already altered, then breeding really isn't, it's not something
it's
that people
not
get into, and it's not recommended.
It's not. An unaltered ferret's really kind of tricky. The males get really stinky and quite aggressive. The females, if they're not bred and they are not altered, can get some pretty profound disease processes. It's just not, it's not worth it.
Right. So the neutering of these animals early is for several reasons. It's not only because breeding them is ill-advised, but they do, females have some significant issues.
Absolutely.
And that's one of the big times, used to be, we hardly ever see it because the vast majority of ferrets are already mm-hmm. spayed, the females, and the males are neutered. But I have had to neuter some neutered males, and mm-hmm. they are rank. I mean, talk about stinky. They're real
stinky.
They're
very, very stinky. And I have read that they groom themselves in their own urine, so you can imagine.
Yeah, so not such a great
no,
idea.
Not something you want to be around.
And so feeding, right, you said, they have an absolute requirement of increased protein levels
right.
higher than the cat, than a typical cat.
I want to say it's about double of a cat.
Yeah. Most, I can remember early on when I first started, when I first became a veterinarian, there a lot of people would feed these guys a ferret. Mm-hmm. I mean, ferrets would feed them, would be
food.
Fed cat
mm-hmm.
food. And there were array of problems associated with that. So there are some very good quality, high quality ferret foods out there that are,
right.
that are more, you know, animal or
mm-hmm.
species appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
So tell me a little bit about the, these guys are how old?
They're about four.
About four?
Mm-hmm. Now, both female.
As far as that, that's pretty middle age, isn't it? Middle age to
it
old.
It is, unfortunately. They don't have as long of a lifespan as, you know, we would like to see. They, 7 to 9 maybe is
right.
a rough estimate. Although I've had ferrets that have lived longer, but that's typically about how long they live.
Yeah, they begin to have a whole array of issues, and we'll talk a little bit about those as
mm-hmm.
time comes on. But you know, after about, from when you get them till 2 or 3, they generally are pretty healthy.
Mm-hmm.
But the problems you're trying to avoid then. So what are the health hazards at that point for the young ones?
Just hazards, really. Ferrets, if they can get into it, they will. If they can't escape, they will, not because they want to get away, but because anything that they can get into is new and fascinating. They can compress, so they can squeeze into tiny, tiny areas, underneath doorways, anything to get out. They eat things they shouldn't. They are known for eating things like remote control buttons, anything styrofoam, spongy, anything like that. And so you've got to really ferret-proof whatever area they're around. If you have cat or dog toys or kids' toys that are textured like that, you got to get rid of them. We've had ferrets eat stuffing, chew up toys and eat stuffing like a puppy might.
Cotton balls,
insoles, anything that you can think of, you got to just get rid of. That one's hard, but you just got to get rid of. And things like recliners are dangerous with ferrets. They like to get up in those things. They use steel, anything that's not tied down. So if all of a sudden your keys are missing, try to check out your ferret's little hiding spot, because chances are that's where you can find it.
So those things we were talking about at the beginning, those are real. That's not
mm-hmm.
just make-believe. These guys are definitely thieves.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to go to the phones. We do have a phone caller. Go ahead, caller. You're on the air. Hello.
Yes?
Hi, how are you tonight?
I'm very well, Dr. Salzburg, and how are you?
I'm great, thanks. What's your question tonight?
My question is, I think you may have already answered it. However, why are ferrets so musty?
I didn't hear
musty.
That.
Why?
Musty? Is that what
musty.
You said? Musty? Oh, musky, the smell.
Yes.
Okay. Well, that might be a good question. I'm not sure I can answer that adequately, but I will tell you that the family, the order of ferrets is actually Mustelidae. So it should give you some idea that this whole group of animals, and there's a whole bunch of animals
skunks.
In this group. Skunks are one of the, you know, well-known examples. Civets, there are wolverines, badgers, minks, sables, ermines, they're all classed at
mm-hmm.
stoats, and the weasels, pine martens, all those things are examples. I can't answer the evolutionary meaning of it, except that many animals use these scents to mark territories and to establish, you know, areas and ranges for themselves. And so, for whatever reason, this group of animals has that's become a very important thing. Some so much that, you know, in case of skunks, where they're actually using these smells as a defensive mechanism, skunks do. I don't know that ferrets do that or any of the other species do. Skunks primarily do that, but I don't know if that answers your question, but it's a good question, though. Mm-hmm. So young ferrets, big deal is that they get into everything. They'll eat things that unfortunately will mm-hmm. go down one end and stick. Mm-hmm. So we end up having to do surgery on these guys more often than we'd not because they tend to get in things. Kind of brings me to one of the things we talked about. What do you think about age as far as owners?
I've never been a big believer that young kids should have ferrets. Ferrets are so squirmy, and a young ferret typically is a nipper, just like getting a puppy. They go through this teething phase, and I've seen some injured where kids just get freaked out. They throw them, they drop them. They aren't responsible as much as they should be, and so then they end up in the cage all the time, not being cleaned. The kids can get bit, which is, you know, obviously most parents don't want that either, but and you can see they're constantly, you have to just know how to handle them. It's really an older kid, usually if they're responsible enough to have a pet, they could probably handle it, but, oh, there you go.
See that? Look
yeah.
at that.
Yeah. What she you got your for? Attention.
What are you doing? Hey, stop. Look at that. See, that's a better reason why a kid wouldn't yeah. want to have a ferret.
They will do that, especially when they're a little older, like her. This one might be ready.
Right.
When they want attention, that's what they do. And
they do
usually,
that.
They'll come up and bite your ankle or something.
Yeah.
It works.
And so, you know, could you imagine if a four-year-old were holding
exactly.
a ferret with that, you know.
And it didn't break the skin, but it'll get your attention.
Yeah. So just something to think about. So young ferrets, again, we've talked about all the things that you really worry about with young ferrets. Then, starting at about the age of, four, four to five.
That's when I say all
so
bets are off.
So what are some of the problems that people deal with? Oh, look at that, I am bleeding.
Oh, I lied, well. Sorry.
Well.
usually the one that you see the most common is adrenal disease. They notice that they start losing their hair, usually at the base of the tail, and it just kind of gets further and further up. And that's very common in older ferrets, middle-aged ferrets even. Different cancers, insulinomas, lymphomas really common. Those are big ones. Those are probably the three big ones that you see, and there are other weird diseases they can get, just like any animal.
I mean, they're prone to tumors and various and sundry other diseases. They can get kind of the whole array of things that other animals get. They mm-hmm. get respiratory infections. Mm-hmm. They can get
pneumonias.
They have an enteritis or an intestinal disease that's not uncommon. These are stress-related mm-hmm. things like that, and a lot of things are stressors, including too hot weather, too cold,
yes.
things like that can be stressors and cause these things to kind of...
Definitely not an animal to keep outside in this heat in Florida.
No, definitely not.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, another thing we talked a little bit about earlier is that these guys, you know, they do have some viral diseases that they can be affected by.
Mm-hmm.
Some of those viruses that we vaccinate against, what mm-hmm. are they?
Oh, they need their, usually, of course, the rabies, which for ferrets, it's not a three-year rabies like a cat or a dog. It's a one-year, every year they need it, as well as their upper respiratory, distemper, that kind of thing. And they get that also every year.
Right, okay, distemper.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, rabies, once a year. I wonder if that ferret's up to date. probably not. But and then, like I said, vaccinations are annual, although mm-hmm. I do know right now there's been a back order on the distemper vaccine.
They do that every now and then,
so
yeah.
I'm not sure when it's going to come back out, but nonetheless, it's important.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, parasites, not a big deal for these guys as a rule because they are born in captivity, mm-hmm. raised and pretty much in captivity.
And hopefully kept inside.
And hopefully kept inside. They can get heartworm mm-hmm. disease, especially if they're housed outside. I don't put inside ferrets on heartworm prevention. However, you can. You can use products like Revolution. It's one of the things that are mm-hmm. that are heartworm preventatives as well. So tell me now, again, we have ferrets. 5 years old is old. The oldest ferret mm-hmm. I can remember having as a patient was, I think, 12. And I you know, I hadn't been seeing it for 12 years, so I just assumed that that's how old it really was. Mm-hmm. But that's really, really rare. Mm-hmm. So it's something else to think about, that these are not particularly long-lived beasties. So,
another reason, you know, maybe not the best for a young child.
Young child, right. Mm-hmm. And again, this here is another good reason why a young child might not want to have it. So I know that ferrets fit sort of a niche for a pretty unique little beast. Tell me, what are the fun things that you've seen your ferrets do that people may not expect?
Something that just amused me was, I had a friend who was over and had his shoes off. They're size 18, huge tennis shoes. And I watched a ferret take about an hour to spend the time to drag that across the room to try to hide it behind the TV. A size 18 tennis shoe that was five times bigger than this animal. And he managed it,
just kept working on it.
Yeah, they're incredibly smart. They're just really a lot of fun. And they have little ferret harnesses and things. Not that you can walk them like a dog, per se, but if you wanted to carry them out to an event or something, just a short-lived event when the weather is not too hot. I've had people do that, and they enjoy it. They have little carrying backpacks and things like that. People can bring their ferrets out.
Bring their ferrets out. You get like a 100 of them, they could pull you on a sled, right?
Or you could do that. I'd like to see that.
So anyway, we wanted to tell all your viewers, you can certainly join us in the discussion. You can call here, ask questions about ferrets or any other veterinary questions you have by calling 1-800-901-9238. How many ferrets have you had over the years?
Oh, a lot. I've never really gotten a total number. At one time, I think I had 14. Most of them rescues. I was kind of working with a rescue group that was overwhelmed at the time. And they had their own room in my house. But that was a lot. It was a lot of work. And that's probably at one time, but definitely, I don't know, 30?
30 ferrets in a lifetime?
Yeah, because they just have such a short life, some of them, you know.
And you've had, and again, I know from experiences that, you know, most of your ferrets have suffered from all the different things that ferrets often get.
Absolutely.
There are some new, you know, management things and some treatments that people might not know about that for some of these diseases. Again, you were talking a little bit about, and I guess it's okay for me to tell you, but some specific problems that ferrets are prone to. The adrenal gland tumors that you discussed and described, again, the early symptoms of that are typically hair loss. Sometimes it's seasonal in the beginning, and you're not sure, but then it becomes more permanent, the hair loss, and that's the most consistent symptom. And there are some newer therapies. There are some implants that can be given that are showing some, I think, significant success. Used to be that we would do surgery on these ferrets and remove the affected adrenal gland. However, that obviously had a lot of particular issues with it. And it wasn't always successful. But now there's a couple of injectable implants, including a melatonin implant and a suprarolin, something like that, which is it's an anti-estrogen testosterone implant that basically suppresses that. Because the adrenal gland disease in these is pretty different than a typical adrenal gland disease we get in either dogs, cats, or humans. And then the other thing that they're fairly prone to is insulinomas, which is a pancreatic tumor. It's an insulin-producing tumor that lives in the pancreas. Some of the early symptoms of that are periods of profound lethargy, where these ferrets will just kind of, lose steam. And I don't mean just tired at the end of the day. I mean, they'd be just cruising along and just kind of run out of steam. And fairly easy to diagnose. Blood sugar on these ferrets, when that's events occurring, are often down in the 20s or 30s. Mm-hmm. You can send blood off and get an insulin level, glucose level pairings, and so it's a fairly easy. Not so easy to treat. Again, surgery is an option, however, not, in my opinion, a great option. But they can be treated with medicine. There are certain types of medication that can help keep these guys going for a long time. It's not considered a cure, but a management, basically a medical management. Again, things like lymphoma, they can be treated with chemotherapy. We had a Dr. Lurie on one of these shows talking about chemotherapy. He talked about it in dogs and cats, but you can do the same thing. And I have treated a few for lymphomas.
I've had a few that have been treated as well.
With some success. Mm-hmm. Again, it's not cure, but it can send it into remission, and they can live pretty good lives. If somebody were interested in ferrets, do you know of any kinds of groups that have, you know, like ferret groups that get together or anything like that?
I don't know of any here. I knew of one in Gainesville. I actually adopted a few at a rescue shelter there who told me about it. But, you know, going online, you can find anything like that out, I'm sure. I just don't know if there's any here in this town.
Right.
I haven't heard of any.
Okay, what do you know anything like about when where these guys are produced? I know there's a couple of different farms that produce them, mm-hmm. but how big is the litter? Do you know? Have any idea?
I've seen pictures. I've never actually seen an actual ferret with a litter, but I think I've read anywhere between 3 and about 8 or 9. It's average, and they're tiny. They're just like kittens or puppies. They are completely dependent on their mothers for some period of time. I think about the same as a puppy, because they don't get to the pet stores till they're about 8 weeks old.
Right. And again, by that time, so you see these pictures of these little baby mm-hmm. ferrets.
And
really, just a fairly short period of time after these pictures are taken, these ferrets are, you know, put under anesthesia mm-hmm. and neutered.
Exactly. Very young.
Spayed or neutered for males, and mm-hmm. then descented at the same time. So they have surgery pretty young, and then we get sent out to... Mm-hmm. To pet shops mm-hmm. and all that. But like you said, also, I know that we've gotten some ferrets in that have come from the Humane Society. So Humane Society will have ferrets that people have relinquished.
Exactly. And
people who didn't plan to do the things that we talked about, get them for too young kids and find out mm-hmm. that, you know, guess what, they bite sometimes. And just to kind
of
give you an idea, this ferret was biting on me. I might have been a little bigger than a normal prey item, but there is this is mind-boggling, but there's actually a wild ferret called a black-footed ferret that lives in Wyoming, Montana, probably other
places.
Very
endangered, unfortunately.
They're very endangered, but these black-footed ferrets, part of the reason they're endangered is because of habitat destruction. But these little tiny ferrets, which are actually smaller than the average fit ferret that we get, mm-hmm. they're smaller. You know what their prey item is? Prairie dogs. They eat prairie dogs. Mm-hmm. Anybody ever seen a prairie dog? They're this big versus
fat.
These ferrets that are, you know, this big, maybe yeah. this big with a tail. So part of the issue is that much of the habitats for the prey items, the prairie dogs, have been destroyed, mm-hmm. developed, changed into cattle farms where they're getting rid of the prairie dogs. So these black-footed ferrets the wild ferrets mm-hmm. have suffered. But my reason for bringing that up, not only for conservation things, but to think of this little tiny beastie pulling down this, you know, 2-pound mm-hmm. mammoth compared to that. Mm-hmm. So that ferret biting me, that wasn't
tenacious.
That particularly unusual. He'd probably eat me if it could have. But it's
Lord.
A good thing to think about when you get ferrets that, they're not for young people. And like you said, many of them when they're young are nippy. Mm-hmm. So give me some ideas of what you do if you have a young ferret that's nippy.
If I have one kind of like that, and they all want to bite just like a puppy, they teeth, but they tend to want to latch. If you scruff them, you can kind of see they immediately just go limp almost always. And this is not hurting her at all, although I do like to tell people to try to support them a little bit so it's not pulling too much. But they'll usually let go. But I have had a couple that have been really nippy, and I've gotten taste deterrents, those things you can get at pet stores, you spray on your hands or on something they're eating that they shouldn't, and it just tastes so foul. Bite once or twice, and then that's it. They'll never bite you again. So that's on more of an extreme. But usually if you're diligent and you just keep making sure they don't do it, and you can kind of see when once you get to know ferrets, you know when they're about to bite because they're sniffing at an area and you know, and you can just get them away from that, and they will typically grow out of it.
Yeah.
The only
that
time
ferret
I've had...
just for me, she licked first.
Yes, that's
she
what they
She was tasting
do.
It first. Yeah, that's pretty good.
And once you get to know them, they usually will do that when they want your attention, and if you're doing something and they're out running around, you'll feel them lick your foot. You know, you've got 5 seconds maybe. So either give them the attention they want or move them. Give them something to distract them because almost all of them will do that when they want your attention.
So
how else are they going to get it, I guess?
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah.
When he was calling me or she was calling me, I didn't pay attention. So so just to think about it again, let's go back through when you things you talked about, those the cages you like are the ones that are built more rather than mm-hmm. bigger, wider, or more
they
vertical.
They really like to climb and they really like hammocks. And plus, you know, those long cages take up so much space. A vertical cage takes up tiny bit of space, but still gives you all the square footage, I guess you'd call it, for the animal.
Right, and because these guys are so curious, it gives them something to do. It gives them a little job.
Tubes and all kinds of things. And they do, I also want to point out, they get along fine with other animals as long as the other animals aren't aggressive towards smaller animals. People always think that their cat's going to eat them. Cat usually wants nothing to do with them. The ferret usually chases the cat. That's typically how they get along. But dogs, anything, as long as you introduce them slowly and make sure the bigger animal's okay with the ferret, they can all get along fine.
Right.
It's not a problem.
Okay, and it's a good thing to remember that, you know, again, if you had a very predatory dog, a big dog, like a Jack Russell Terrier or something like that, maybe not a good combination.
Exactly.
So, something to think about. But I know I've seen your ferrets and your cats play.
Mm-hmm.
Play
well,
very
they usually terrorize the cats, but I guess you'd call that play.
We're getting close. Any quick calls? No questions? I hope you got a lot out of this tonight, because I think it's important you realize it was kind of good that this guy bit me, that let you know that they're not particularly innocent. They can get a little randy at time. But we are out of time. And if you are not able to get your question answered, you can email us at wdsc@daytonastate.edu. I want to thank my guest, Terri Lewis, and thank her for bringing in her ferrets. I hope that you enjoyed the show. And I want you to join me next week on another edition of Pet Owners Hotline.